Except for the United States, the majority of film-producing countries, England, France, Germany, and Italy, were involved in World War I from its outbreak. The United States did not enter the war until 1917, and then our participation was far less than total. Since some of the materials required for the manufacture of high explosives are the same as those for photographic film, such as cotton and nitric and sulfuric acids, film stock was in short supply abroad. A much more serious effect of war on European film producers was the curtailment of international distribution of completed films. Nations were separated from each other by battle lines. Transportation was unavailable for many non-military purposes, and the large American audience lay 3,000 miles across a submarine-infested ocean. Although the French and the Italian had been the first to arrive on the scene with a feature-length film, and all the French movie industry had achieved unquestionable dominance by 1910, the United States was now in an enviable position to pursue the development as no other country at that time could. With its sizable movie-going public, an economy stimulated rather than drained by the war, a tradition of business expertise, and filmmakers of considerable inventiveness and genius, the United States had a crucial advantage at this important stage. The Americans made full use of their resources, and that is to our credit. If there had not been that four-year lead at exactly that historical moment, the subsequent domination of the world screens by the United States might never have occurred, or at least not to the extent that it did. As it happened, from 1915 to 1919, the Americans were the ones who expanded the art to a fuller expression, discovered the sorts of ingredients that would make the entertainment universally popular, and devised a system of manufacture, wholesaling, and retailing that could support the new expense of feature production. In the United States at this time, three parallel developments occurred that deserve particular attention. First was the culmination of D.W. Griffith's earlier experimentation in film for his first features. Second, a very special tradition of American screen comedy began in the output of Mack Sennett and his co-workers, most notably Charlie Chaplin. And finally, the new and prototypical systems of mass production, distribution, and exhibition evolved, with Thomas H. Ince among the leaders in organizing production, laying the groundwork for subsequent economic expansion. Our focus today will be on D.W. Griffith. Griffith worked in both large and small scale. Many of his films that have aged well, or his scenes remembered with great pleasure, are close, intimate studies of character and feeling. An example of this can be seen in his film, Broken Blossoms. Still, what was needed to shake film completely free of the stage in a way so conspicuous that no one could fail to understand was probably the kind of spectacular grandeur that was represented in Griffith's two films, The Birth of a Nation, 1915, and Intolerance, 1916. Except for their length and their expense, any other single element in either of these two films could no doubt be found in many of the other more than 400 films that D.W. Griffith made at this time. To bring together all of these contributions, however, under complete control and under such a gigantic scale, was truly a staggering accomplishment. Nothing like these two films in their size, in their intricacy, in their sense of conception, and their mingling of history with passionate argument had ever appeared before. The Birth of a Nation is a paradigm for the successful big Hollywood pictures through Gone with the Wind, 1939, to Titanic, 1997, and beyond. It also establishes the technique and style of filmmaking that has come to be called classic Hollywood cinema. The Birth of a Nation broke all sorts of precedents. Even in production, its cost, approximately $110,000, was said to be five times greater than the next largest sum spent on an American film up to that time. Having run through his backers' money, Griffith invested what he could raise and borrowed on his own to finish it. There were 6 weeks of rehearsal. Shooting extended from July to October of 1914. Editing took another 3 months. This overall production time contrasted with the average in those days of 6 weeks or less. When completed, The Birth of a Nation's length was an unexpected, unprecedented 3 hours. It was the first American film to be accompanied throughout by a symphonic score. The score was especially composed by Joseph Carl Briel. In 1915, the film opened as The Klansman in Los Angeles, and then as The Birth of a Nation in New York. The title change was suggested by Dixon, the author of the novel, who felt something was needed to suggest the epic scope of Griffith's achievement. The new title referred to the end of the sovereignty of the state achieved by the victory over secession. Although it played in legitimate theaters for as much as $2 per ticket, it has been estimated that the first 6 months of its national run drew more people than had attended all the performances of all the stage plays in the United States in any given 5-year period. More than merely a motion picture, it was a cultural phenomena that everyone felt obliged to witness. Because of its evident racial biases, it created enormous controversy, even riots, and the notoriety attracted still more customers. It is its passionate certainty that made The Birth of a Nation not only a success, but a scandal. Although based in part on Dixon's novel, Griffith recreated the narrative world according to his own viewpoint. Born in Kentucky in 1875, he absorbed an understanding of the Civil War and Reconstruction from his father, Colonel Roaring Jake Griffith of the Confederate Cavalry. The attitudes about black people in Birth of a Nation are so much part of the total view of life the film encompasses that Griffith was evidently shocked when he was accused of racism. There are many who cannot accept the content of Griffith's films. Not just the racial bias in The Birth of a Nation, but the sentimentality and the melodramatics that color so much of his presentation and possibly his view of life. Even in his own time, this conception, rooted in 19th century Victorianism, apparently came to seem increasingly old-fashioned and irrelevant to his audiences. Some critics, unwilling to allow for what others see as style, a set of conventions, a way of thinking about people and events, have tended to deplore the content while praising the form. But all agree that in The Birth of a Nation, Griffith's formal control over the medium achieved an unprecedented power. As part of the Birth of a Nation controversy, Griffith had published a pamphlet entitled The Rise and Fall of Speech in America. Then, apparently wanting to align himself clearly on the side of unquestionable social and moral rectitude, to show his detractors how they had misunderstood him, and perhaps to castigate those he felt had been intolerant toward him, he conceived an even more elaborative narrative structure than he had for A Birth of a Nation. Added to The Mother and the Law were 3 other stories set in widely disparate historical periods and cultures. These 4 stories, according to a title prefacing the multi-layered whole, would show how hatred and intolerance through the ages have battled against love and charity. This undertaking, which perhaps remains the most ambitious in conception and largest in size of any film ever produced in the United States, became Intolerance, released in 1916. In order to finance this colossal spectacle, Griffith used all his profits from The Birth of a Nation, finally buying out the other backers when they lost their nerve. The total cost of the picture is said to have been $1.9 million, a pittance by today's standards, but a fortune in 1916. Intolerance originally ran close to 4 hours, longer than Birth of a Nation, and again a special score was composed by Joseph Carl Briel, according to Griffith's specifications. The sentimental idealism of Intolerance carries nothing of the direct conviction of the Birth of a Nation, and was a dismal and financial failure, as much as the preceding film had been an unrivaled success. Intolerance was to have an influence on film history quite disproportionate to its lack of popular appeal. After the war, Lenin arranged for it to tour the new Soviet Union, where it ran continuously for 10 years. Lenin was most interested in the portrayal of exploitative and repressive managerial classes in the modern society, Griffith's viewpoint being strongly anti-capital and pro-labor. But two future giants of Soviet cinema, Sergei Eisenstein and V.I. Potovkin, saw much more in it than that. Griffith had shown them how argument, education, and propaganda could be conveyed through dramatic incident, and how its effectiveness could be heightened by the dynamics of editing. Most of what the Soviet film masters formalized and articulated in theories of montage, Griffith had understood intuitively. In Intolerance, the evolving unity rests on generalized idea and emotion, rather than solely on characters' decisions to forward the plot, and depends on the unique resource of the film medium. Through skillful juxtaposition of images, disjunctive in physical place and time, but related by each phase of the developing theme, the effect of the whole becomes greater than the sum of its parts. In other respects, Intolerance represents Griffith's growing mastery over the medium. The alteration between the large vista and the small human detail is even more assured. Performances are completely non-stage-like and are carefully broken into shots, with especially forceful use of close-ups. Considerable camera movement was introduced. The long, crane-like dolly shot into the palace courtyard, the pan across the seated woman in the marriage market, not to follow action, but to compel our close attention to the woman. The full range of irises, fades, superimpositions, and masking are employed throughout, all done in the camera. In total, Intolerance is felt by many to represent Griffith's fullest achievement. For all, it must stand as one of the great landmarks in the history of film. If you're watching the supplemental portion online, you will find an exercise to do after you've completed the viewing. The exercise is done online. An immediate response showing your comprehension of what you've just viewed will appear on the screen after you've submitted the exercise.